Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "As you have sent me into the world, so I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." The Gospel of the Lord. Margaret, in welcoming you to speak to us at this novena, we make visible the unity for which Jesus prayed in that gospel that I have just read. As the followers of Jesus, we profess one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And we pray that your presence in Clonard here today will inspire in all of us a passion for the unity of the body of Christ. And so I invite you now to speak to the congregation.
I want to thank you for that very kind invitation to speak here this morning. I'm a Methodist minister. I'm married to David. I have three grown-up children, three grandchildren, and I entered ministry late in life. But currently I am the minister, superintendent minister of the Greater Shankill Circuit, and I have responsibility for both Woodvale and Shankill Methodist. And also as part of my responsibility, I engage in some of the work that goes on in Fourth Spring, just up the road. Even though I'm on the other side of that peace wall, I am your neighbour. And my parish has got the same problems and issues that lie around this parish. So in many ways, I feel we're already one in the Lord. Before I speak, let's just take a moment to pray. Father God, we thank you for your precious word. And I pray that the words that I speak and the meditation of each one of our hearts would be pleasing unto you. Amen. Today our text is confess one Lord, one faith, one baptism. But what does that mean in the context of our readings? What does that mean in the context of a divided society, separated by a wall, where the people of God struggle with division? In that passage that we read from John 17, it takes us to those last moments that Jesus spends with his disciples. And I want us to picture the scene. Here is Jesus. He knows what lies ahead of him. There's a mock trial. There's going to be verbal abuse and ridicule. A terrible scourging and beating. And then that awful crucifixion. And yet Jesus sets all of this human concern to one side. And what does he do? He looks up to heaven and he prays for us. And he pleads for us. And he pleads that God's followers would be one. And he prays for unity. Now Jesus is not praying that we would all be clones of one another, Rather, he is praying that his disciples are united in one purpose. And what is that one purpose? Well, he says it. So that the world may know that you have sent me and that you love them just as much as you love me. In other words, Jesus is praying that his followers will get the focus of their mission right. And Jesus makes that mission even more clear when he tells it at the end of Matthew in that final command. And he says there, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. You see, God's people are called firstly to be disciples, a people who seek to walk closely with God, who honor him, and who live lives that reflect that call. But then they are called to make more disciples. And this Jesus, who is about to face his death, is more interested in us. His interest is that we should love each other as he loves us. And Paul picks up that theme when he writes to the Ephesians in that second passage. And he also challenges the church in his day to work towards that unity of purpose. He urges, implores, and pleads that they would seek to heal their divisions. And he says, there is one body. Paul uses images that we can understand. You see, there are certain things that I can do with my hands that I cannot do with my feet. But likewise, my feet are good for walking. Can I tell you, I'm no good on my hands. It's the same with other parts of my body. And Paul says those who are reconciled to God through Christ become part of the same family, part of the same body. And that body is called Christ's church. You see, God was neither a Protestant nor a Catholic, not a Methodist nor a Presbyterian, because denomination or division were never ever on his radar. Friends, we are either in the body of Christ or we are not. Then Paul says there is one Spirit. Followers of Christ will be marked by the same Spirit, and that's the Holy Spirit. There is only one Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is the one who works within us to transform us and to encourage us. Now, transformation means change. But if I'm going to change, I need the Holy Spirit to challenge me. And I need to surrender my will and my desire to God. Because the Holy Spirit wants to help us live out lives that show that fruit that is mentioned in Galatians 5. That fruit of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Does the world not need that today? Does our society not need those things today? Does our community not need those today? And is that fruit evidenced in the lives of the people who call themselves the people of God? The people who call themselves Christian? Do people look at us and see evidence of God at work in our lives? Are they attracted by what they see? Then he says there is one hope. We are part of a family. And when we're part of any family, we are heirs to that family's fortunes, or as in my case, the lack of family fortune. But the Bible tells us that if we love God with all our heart, soul, and minds, if we trust in Jesus and in his work on that cross, if we're open to the challenge of his Holy Spirit, then we are children of God. And consequently, we are adopted into God's family. And we become heirs to his promises and to his privileges. So what is the hope that comes out of that? Jesus promises that there will be life in all its fullness in the here and now. And he says in Luke 14, verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, and to set the oppressed free. Brothers and sisters, I need that hope in my community. Do we all need that hope in our communities? And then he promises that when we die, there will be eternal life. Then he says there is one Lord. The Bible tells us that Christ is the head of the body, the head of the church, the head of the people of God, those who call themselves Christian. That means that God demands the number one position in my life and in your life. So is God my highest loyalty? Is God your highest loyalty? Is he the one who takes first place in our lives? Or have we replaced him with other idols? Idols like materialism, things, ornaments, clothes, new cars, new homes, whatever. Idols of pleasure, holidays, drugs, alcohol, shopping. Idols of people, pop stars, footballers, film icons. Idols of buildings. What excites us? What vies for our attention? Because all these things vie for our attention. But what wins? Are we here today because it's duty? Are we here today because it's something that placates our conscience? Friends, we mustn't kiss the altar rails and miss the one who loves us. Because is Jesus Lord and Master of your life and my life? You know, when I get to heaven, God is not going to say to me, "What church did you go to, Margaret?" He's going to take a stethoscope and he's going to put it at my heart and he's going to listen to the beat of my heart. And he's going to know, where does my love lie? Is God my passion? Is God my first love? Then he says there is one faith. Jesus and Paul implore us to be unified in what is core to our faith. We share the teaching of the Apostles' Creed. Jesus was born of the Virgin Mary. God became incarnational. He came and he lived on this earth. He died on a cross. He died to pay the price of my sin and your sin. And he rose again. And he died because he had to rise. He died because sin causes us to die. And in dying, Jesus defeated the power of death's hold over us, because he rose and defeated that power of death. We no longer have to be bound in a human grave, but we can rise with Jesus and have eternal life. That is central to our Christian faith, and we all share it. Then he says there is one baptism. Baptism is that public declaration of our allegiance to God through Christ. But baptism does not end when the water dries up. It is the start of an ongoing life of getting to know God through prayer, through Bible study, and allowing him to direct our lives. Baptism symbolizes that Jesus is Lord of our lives. Whenever we ask for our child to be baptized, is that what you're thinking about? Thinking about starting a process where you will bring that little child to a place where he or she will become a faithful follower of Christ. Friends, churches come in all sizes and shapes. Different styles of worship happen in them. But Paul is at pains to remind us that the Church of Jesus Christ is not about the buildings. It's not about denominations. It's not about any ritual pattern of worship. But it is about the people of God. And he urges the church in his day to be a people of every race and nation who love Christ, a people who are committed to serving him, Where people are passionate about God, they infect others. And so Paul urges that church in Ephesians not to hide their passion for God, but to show it in the kind of lives that they live. We are to stand firm. To stand firm in God. To infect the world in which we live with God's love. With God's desire for justice and peace. And we are to live lives that show that God wants the very best for all his children in this world, as well as the next. One faith, one Lord, one baptism. Friends, unity is our purpose and our mission. And it is to live a life that is passionately in love with God. God first. And then out of that passion, others will know that he lives. Amen.
Thank you, Margaret. Just the petitions. Mother of perpetual help, I come to ask the help of your divine Son. Please pray to him for my beautiful friend who is going in for a very big operation on Friday. She has three little children, and we're very worried about what the doctor might find. May his hands and his mind successfully treat her. Dear Mother, watch over her and her family. I pray for my brother who suffers from a mental illness. He's tried to take his life twice. Pray that he may gain peace of mind. Pray for a dear friend who is losing a long battle with cancer and is distressed. May he get strength and peace before he passes away. Look after him and his family. Pray for all my family, especially the ones who seem to have gone away from their faith, that they will return again to the Eucharist. Pray for me that I may be a better person and keep my children and grandchildren from all the evil in this world. Pray for all my family. We lost our granny almost a year ago on my birthday. Pray that we may all stay strong, especially my granda, and that we may keep her memory alive by having faith in you and always acting in your likeness. Dear Mother, ask your divine Son to help me to be a better person in all areas of my life, because I'm not much of a person, as you know. The last petition, dear Mother, help me to build my business up and give me strength and direction in which to do this, that I can make a better life for myself and those around me. And we remember too today, we ask Our Lady to pray for the Woodvale Methodist Congregation and Shankill Methodist Congregation and all the Methodist congregations with whom our Clonard Unity Pilgrims have met in friendship and prayer in the past year. And I ask Father John then to lead us in the Novena prayer on page 18.
Mother of perpetual help, with the greatest competence, we come before your holy picture to be inspired by the we think of you at the moment when, full of faith and trust, you accepted God's call to be the mother of his Son. Help us, your children, to accept the joy of the calling of life. When you learned that your cousin Elizabeth was in need, you immediately went to serve her and offer your help. Help us, like you, to be prepared for her. We think of you, Mother, at the foot of the cross. Your heart must have bled, seemed to have been angry, and your joy was great when he was dead. Mother of our sorrow, help us with the trials and disappointments of life. Let us know. May we share in you the joy of all the challenges of our life. Amen.
So if you're kneeling, please be seated, and we'll continue now with the offertory, and we'll sing All That I Am, All That I Do on page 55, and during the hymn the baskets will be passed along for our collection for today. 55.